Now, if you were watching Autumn Watch, or indeed last night, you'll know that we've joined up with the University of Brighton in an experiment, a study of urban foxes, and we've collared them so that we can learn more about their habits. These are the animals that we're looking at the moment. It's a pair of foxes, one that we think is the son, Fenwick, and the other one, which we think is the father, which is Fleet. Now, Fleet was top fox, of course, but then we saw this already. Look, the youngster's pushing him out, away from the food. He got a bit of a cough, and he skulked off into the undergrowth. But he went beyond the undergrowth. He went much, much further. The big question was, just how far has Fleet gone? Now, since Fleet was chucked out by his son, Dr. Dawn Scott has been following his every move. What happened then, Dawn?
We noticed that he'd cleared completely out of Brighton and he'd headed off into rural countryside. There's so many foxes around and so many fox territories, there was no space for him, so he kept on going, as far as we know.
I thought we were walking to find our friend Fleet.
We've got a little bit of a road trip to go, yeah.
Our so-called suburban fox has headed right to the top of the South Downs. After just 2 days, Fleet had travelled 7 kilometres and reached Ditchling Beacon, one of the highest points in southeast England. Wow, he came all the way up here.
He hung around here for a couple of days. He walked up and down the South Downs Way, but he didn't stay here for long. He's carried on heading north.
He left on the 9th of December.
Yeah.
So where was he by Christmas?
Shall I go and show you? It's about 200 kilometres away.
Oh, my goodness me. We better drive, come on.
The British record for a distance covered by a dispersing fox had been 52 kilometres. Fleet soon smashed that. He spent the next 9 days zigzagging between the South Downs and various towns and villages to the north. So what was he up to? Was he looking for a territory? And fighting lungworm, was he too weak to take on any of the resident males he met? Perhaps he was on the trail of a female, but why would one vixen travel so far herself? No, most likely, Fleet was looking for food. Used to scavenging handouts, catching enough live prey in the countryside would have been pretty tough for him. But on December the 18th, Fleet headed back south to the busy A27. Then, at 11:30 in the morning, his signal stopped. One of Dawn's students, Naomi, traced the last signal to a busy junction. She went out, but she failed to find the fox, dead or alive. But then, that night, Fleet's signal was back on. Maybe he'd been resting underground, but now he was on the move again.
He seems to be navigating using railway lines and roads and following tracks. Some cases where he's come to a river and you can see that he's gone up and down the river trying to find a safe place to cross. It's been relatively mild, but it's been very wet, so I think he's probably had a few challenges.
Unsurprisingly, Fleet did nearly all of his travelling at night.
And he doesn't seem to stop, he keeps going and keeps going. And then about 5, 6 o'clock in the morning, he seems to start moving around a bit, slowing down, and trying to find somewhere to rest during the day. And most of the places where he's resting are suburban gardens, where I think he probably feels safest.
But then, on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, Fleet spent a whole 2 days in this caravan park near Uckfield.
So I'd be very interested if anyone was feeding him or anyone saw him whilst he was here.
Because you were here for 2 days?
2 days, yeah.
It's turkey.
On Boxing Day, Fleet's record-breaking journey continued, and by early January, he'd covered over 300 kilometres. But then his signal went dead. Nothing for 4 days.
So this is the last place we had a location at 11:30 at night. And you can see it's a really busy road.
Oh dear, I don't feel good about this. I feel I've got to do the grisly duty and go and have a look. I mean, horribly, 11:30 at night on this road, traffic at these speeds, it's not good, is it?
It's not good, and that's why I wanted to check whether he was about or not, whether he had actually been hit.
Even with daylight fading fast, we would smell roadkill. And there's no sign of fleet. At nightfall, we have to give up.
I don't know what to say. I didn't find anything.
No.
So I'm hoping that's good news.
I think that's good news. He might have lasted longer than the collar. I think Fleet's out there somewhere, wandering around. He still keep going. He's a tough old dog. 315 kilometres travelled in less than a month. That's amazing.
You've got yourself a record-breaking fox.
What an incredible journey.
Amazing.
That's astonishing.
I know, in a month.
But what do you think's happened to him?
Well, what you didn't see there was that I spent a lot longer looking for that animal. I had the torch. In fact, I met up with a walker, a guy with a golden retriever, and we were both looking for the best part of an hour. I think I would have found it. I scoured that roadside, and he sniffed around with his dog. I think we'd have found it. So my thought is there's been a lot of flooding. We know that Fleet had been swimming through some of the rivers. The collar had packed up once and come back on already. I think water got into it. I'm certain that he's still out there. I'm not just saying that, you know, I'm not just saying that. Normally I'm pessimistic, but I'm being truthful. We would have found him.
Fleet could still be alive.
I'm sure he is, but unfortunately we're not getting any more data.
Well, I hope you're right.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain that I am right.
By the way, have you seen the change in the weather?
I have.
Look at
that.
It. It's snowing. It's we now finally have snow.
I know. Now, look. We've had that data that we did get from Fleet, and this is what we've seen, this remarkable 315-kilometre journey all the way across Sussex there, finally ending up here where we lost him. And as I say, he's probably still out there. I mean, he could have travelled a great distance. I mean, one thing to say is that if you're anywhere within this sort of radius, which is, I suppose, south of the N25 and Dover, and you see a fox with a collar, then let us know, because it could be him. But one thing that it could point out is how the spread of urban foxes has occurred. Previously, we thought they didn't go very far. The 25 kilometres was about the average. Now we know they go a lot further. It might explain this. You see, foxes only became urbanised in the 1930s when we started building suburbia. It was that that lured them into our cities. And initially, we found them in cities pretty much in the south and the west. They were in Bristol, they were in Brighton, they were in London. But then in the last 30 years, they've begun to spread. And each one of these dark triangles here isolates and identifies a city which has been occupied by urban foxes in that time. So you can see they've now spread as far north as Newcastle. But they haven't made it, strangely, to Merthyr Tydfil, Barrow-in-Furness, Kettering and Bury St Edmunds here. No reports of urban foxes in those places. So if you happen to live in one of those places and you've seen an urban fox, we'd love to hear about it. But, you know, it's brilliant that these animals have made such a success of this, and they're doing it worldwide. In the similar period, last 25 years, they've urbanised themselves in the United States, Australia, Canada and Japan. We thought that we had about 33,000, Michaela, in the 1990s. But we think now, because we've built even more houses and even more people are feeding them and there's even more waste food in our cities, that that population might have increased.
I'm sure it has. But it's incredible just how much information we're getting from those groundbreaking collars. I mean, did you think for 1 minute that a fox could travel that far?
No, I didn't. We knew that some foxes would travel great distances in other countries, but in this country we didn't. I mean, this is fantastic stuff. We're learning so much more quickly with these collars. I have to say, we're going to learn more tomorrow. The great journey might have ended, but another one of our fox stars, ones which live in the inner city, right in the heart of Brighton, one of them's called Silver, and it seems he's found himself a lady. Tune in tomorrow night for a little bit of fox romance.
Fantastic. Yeah. It's a little happy ending there. Well, it seems like foxes aren't the only ones that are spreading their territory. It seems that this bird is doing the same. It's a jay, and it's only been seen around Mar Lodge in the last 11 years, and now it's actually seen quite regularly. Now, this is what you're used to seeing jays doing, caching their acorns in the autumn, stashing them away so that they've got plenty to eat in the winter. Now, we've been seeing a lot of these jays on one of our cameras. We've, in fact, called it now J-Cam, and it's doing something that might surprise you. Have a look. It's eating carrion. Is that surprising? Well, not really, because actually they have a very varied diet. They eat a lot of nuts, fruits, seeds, insects, eggs, small birds, and they will take advantage of any dead meat. You know, when times are tough in the winter, these birds are opportunistic, and that is a jolly good meal for them.
Nice birds as well. Nice
beautiful
to see them in close
birds.
Up like that. Set up these cameras, we expect golden eagles and buzzards, we get jays, but it's just as good.